back in the studio with an antenna pointed at my chin. This is Ham Radio Now, episode 269, Bull and a China Shop. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. This represents the China Shop. I'm the Bull. Before we get into that, I want to go someplace else. I got an email from one of the major fans of the show, from Mark Cartwright, regarding the on-the-road segment that we did, episode 268. Another great on-the-road video. Appreciate it. DCC was good, Mark. Had a good time. Those videos are going to be coming out pretty soon, the first couple, but I got a few things to get out of the way first. I say out of the way as if it's a bad thing. As if this is all clutter till we do the DCC. I have other episodes that have been waiting, including this one. So Mark is pointing me to another ham who is doing another show, Jason KC5HWB. He does the Ham Radio 2.0 podcast, and he has just done an on-the-road version, and Mark thinks he did it pretty well. Says he wouldn't consider it competition, but kind of a competition. You know, two guys, different shows, same hobby. And then he looked at his, so he's been watching Jason's show for a while. And I actually met Jason at Dayton. I interviewed him. That interview has not appeared on Ham Radio Now yet, but Jason, it will. Don't worry. It will. You're coming up. Mark looked at his recent episode and noticed something interesting. That's Jason's recent episode there on the left. An on-the-road version, his episode 59. Here's mine, episode 268, even more on the road. Almost the exact same shot. I don't know if Jason planned that or not, but it caught Mark's attention, so I thought it was pretty good. By the way, Mark is... I never mentioned his call sign because I never remember it because we don't talk on the air. It's KD5BVX. So thank you for pointing that out, Mark. It is interesting. Jason has modeled some of his show on Ham Radio Now. It's clear, and he says so. And I am flattered at the, not exactly mentoring, but I'm the role model for doing his program. But he does many different things. He does a lot more unboxings and radio reviews and stuff like that. But he has also, over the course of his programs, done some forums and seminars at Hamfests. So he does some things like I do in places I can't get to. So that's very cool. He's sort of like an outpost of Ham Radio Now. So I am curious what his on-the-road segment looks like. So I'm going to take a look here. This is his website, Ham Radio 2.0. It is double branded. It is also branded Live from the Ham Shack. And for those of you just listening, if you want to go check it out, it is livefromthehamshack.tv. And he does an audio version like I do. You can subscribe to it. So here's his episode 59, The Journey to Joplin. And let's get it started.
Ham Radio 2.0 on the road. Journey to Joplin.
I just said that, Jason.
Journey to Joplin. I don't know what episode this is going to be because it's going to be a future episode somewhere past 50.
I do that all the time. You're copying me there, Jason. I do that all the time. Video.
Because you can't see my radios, which are down here beneath the camera right now.
I think I've solved that problem.
You at the road. Or point you at the,
sort of.
At the radio.
I need a light on my radio so you can see them better.
Well, the trip is 6 hours.
Because they kind of disappear into a black hole when it's looking out a bright windshield.
And hearing me in the background.
And I think you need to clean your windshield there, Jason. Okay, let's get him on the road a little bit. Okay, he cleaned his windshield. And let's see, does he say what he's going to do? I think he does. Oh, it's an experimental video, so this is his first one. So, yeah, I've done a few now. I'm getting the techniques. He'll brush it up. He's going to talk on Brandmeister through DMR, some 220 repeaters in the Tulsa, Oklahoma area, and he'll do more. If this video gets interest, he'll do some more.
Treat him like little kids. Love it. Okay, I'm out of here. Good morning, everybody. This is Fast Talking Craig.
Okay.
K6VGZ. But I'll be listening. And take it away, whoever.
So Jason's Ham Radio 2.0, live from the Ham Shack. Some similarities to Ham Radio Now, but it's a really different show. And, you know, I really ought to invite Jason to come on Ham Radio Now sometime. Stop that so it stops using up the bandwidth. And kibitz about doing ham radio videos. Like me, he is making himself into a celebrity, a pundit. Maybe. Something like that. All right. Let's see. Before we go any farther, Ham Radio Now is brought to you by you. If you enjoy the programs, get something out of them. This is standard pattern for me now. Arvin is sitting back there watching the proceedings. Stop by hamradionow.tv, and you can make a contribution either through Patreon, PayPal, credit card, and occasionally at Hamfest, people hand me wads of cash. So, good deal. Thank you very much. So, bull in a China shop. Again, this is the China. This is the BaoFeng UV5X3. They're 2 meter, 220, 440. Brand new radio. Just came out in August. I haven't paid a lot of attention to the Chinese radios. Certainly haven't bought any until this one, the handhelds. I've been aware of them. They've been hitting the U.S. market for, I think, not quite 10 years. And they came with a reputation of being cheap, very cheap, down to $35 for some models. This thing, I think, was about $70. Cheap, inexpensive, sometimes cheaply made, hard to program, at least manually, confusing, but cheap. And they got very popular because a lot of hams were attracted to the low price. If it was the first radio for a brand new ham, well, that's an easy entry. And why not? Or for a ham who's had plenty of other radios, but is looking for a backup radio or something they can tote around and not worry too much if they destroy it out in the field. You're going fishing, you can drop it in the river. You know, it's not that expensive, so they become a little bit expendable. So I needed to pay more attention to them. Now, I have seen a couple of Chinese mobile radios. I reviewed them in two issues of QST. Let's take a look. The October 2013 issue, way up there for focus. And I reviewed the Anytone UV-AT5888 dual band transceiver. Let's see. Let's get to the bottom line real quick. The bottom line was, it's okay. It'll get you on the air inexpensively. It's got some good features, some significant drawbacks. And one of the interesting things about this radio is that it looked exactly like, or very similar to, another radio I've already had. It's this one, the Yaesu 8900, or the 8800, since the 8900 is quad band. And this radio is just dual band. So if you look carefully at the control panels, very similar to the names on the dials or the names on the knobs. So really similar. That is sort of where the similarities ended. I wasn't very happy with the radio. It was okay, but the programming was goofy and the operation was goofy. And so it did not impress me as a replacement radio. And it wasn't all that cheap. It's, you know, they were in the couple of $100 range. And the Yaesus are more than that, but not that much more than that. The next one is from the April 2014 issue, so about a year later. And this was, I know how to pronounce this, the Osheng dual band transceiver. And that wasn't copied off of anybody. But the bottom line, pretty much the same thing. It'll get you on the air at a low price, some good features, some compromises. So not real excited about those mobile radios, but I had not played with the handheld radios. And when this one came out, the 2 meter 220 440, at about $70, so not the cheapest of the Chinese radios, but pretty cheap, I wanted to get to know it better. So I ordered one, I think, through Amazon, and started playing with it. So before I go any farther, when it first came, it was in a box. I did my first unboxing. My first, not quite my last, because I also did a little unboxing of the Titerra MD380 DMR radio. We'll do that one in a upcoming episode. I'm still learning that. It's much more complex because of the DMR part. But I pulled this one out of the box. I did it as a live Facebook video, one of my first. That video disappeared from Facebook. Somehow, poof. Facebook sent me a note, a warning saying they were having trouble encoding it, I think. It had already been encoded. It was online. People had watched it, about 160 or so. And then poof, it disappeared. But I recorded the unboxing. So let's pull this thing out of the box. So let's take a look at what's inside the box. Here is the box. It is, I think I got it through Amazon, but the return address does say BaoFeng Tech, BaoFeng. Again, no idea how to pronounce it. In Lexington, Kentucky is where it shipped from. So here is what's inside the box. I bought the programming cable as well. So here's the programming cable. The only other thing, oops, is the radio itself. And it is the UV5X3. So let's open the box. I am not good at unboxings, because I've never done one before, so I don't know how to open it. I should have practiced this, I guess. There we go. The unboxing concept has been very big. I've never understood quite the appeal of just opening a box for the first time without doing serious program, a test of the radio and review and figuring out how it works, stuff like that. But apparently they're very popular. So this is going to shoot the Ham Radio Now view count into the stratosphere, I'm sure. Okay, so there's the box opened up, and here's what we see inside. The manual. And a radio. And I think a battery. And I'm not sure what else. And I realize pointing it that way is not really good, because I can't see it. Okay, so this appears to be the radio. And that does appear to be the battery. So there'll be some more in there. There'll be a charger. And an antenna. There's a little antenna. What is this? Ooh. Looks like it's an earphone and probably a microphone. Yeah, so I didn't know this was coming with it. Earphone and mic thing. And I'm going to guess it doesn't work very well. Doesn't stay in the ear very well and doesn't sound very good, but worth a try. Oh, here's a closer look at the radio, and I guess I'll take the package off, and we'll compare it. A little taller than the Kenwood. And it's going to be a little thinner, perhaps. About the same width. So, still a pretty small radio. There's two antennas in here. Yeah, I think I read that they would send two antennas, and I think that their deal is that one is 220 megahertz and one is 2 meters and 70 centimeters. So apparently they had the same problem that the Kenwood did, and they couldn't make the stock antenna work on all three bands. Let's see. I'm curious at the connector. What gender are we? Yeah. That's too bad. It's the reverse gender from what most radios are. So I won't be able to use my existing antennas on it. Back to work. The rest of the box. This is the battery charger. There's a drop-in charger and a wall charger. So both of those. I don't know if the drop-in charger is going to be a rapid charger or not. Okay, well, the wall charger, I think it just goes into the drop-in charger. It's not really a charger. There might be enough of a residual charge to actually do something. All I got to do is figure out which way to put the battery in. There we go. Take off the protective covering. So the display is not real big, but you know, it's probably about the same size. Yeah, not about the same size as what was on the Kenwood. Doesn't have to show a lot. Oh, which antenna is which? I've lost one of the antennas already. And there's the other. And I don't know which one's which. Something says on the bottom. Yeah, this one is 220 megahertz. Where's my focal point? Somewhere in there. That one's 220. And this one is 144 and 440. So we'll try that first. So this will be a part of the test. Can I figure out how to turn it on? Here's something that that I think I noted when I read it. This is a Kenwood speaker mic, and I think it said that it matches the Kenwood speaker mic accessories. And unfortunately, Kenwood's doesn't match ICOM's or Yaesu's. I think ICOM and Yaesu are the same. Kenwood, everybody puts their earphones on the big pin and the microphone on the small pin, and Kenwood reverses it and puts their earphone on the little pin, which means you can't use a standard earphone, and the microphone on the big pin. And, oops. Physically, it's going to work. So, how do you turn it on? VFO memory, AB, band, menu, exit, and a bunch of other stuff. Probably not one of those. Call, monitor. Oh, really? It's the power's on the little volume control. So let me see if I can figure out how to program an offset. Turning this so that I can read it. Skip. TXP. Don't know what that means. Save. Don't know what that means. Scan. Vox. WN. Don't know what that means. ABR. Don't know what that means. SQL. Squelch. That's probably squelch, so. Can't figure out how to use it. Oh, that's interesting. I think I've figured out how to set the squelch. Although, if I've just set it to zero, it's not open. Ha ha! You got to do the confirm. Oh no. Yeah, it's that goofy Chinese programming. So I'm not seeing an offset yet. Ah, and there it is. Offset. So, I think I will want 000. Oops. 600. And I'm assuming this is all megahertz and kilohertz. Megahertz over there, kilohertz over here. And now how do we tell it what direction? Oops. Didn't confirm it. Okay, but what direction? What is that? Frequency direction. Plus, minus, off. So minus is what we want for this repeater. So I'm finding it. It's clunky, but I'm finding it. And we exit. And this is a carrier access repeater. But I'm not sure I'm even going to hear it because of all the noise around here. Oh, yeah, almost hearing that repeater. The display is doing the correct offset. KN4AQ. Oh, yeah, I keyed it up. I could just about barely hear it. KN4AQ testing. Too noisy in here. So, be back with more of this program when we've got the radio all figured out. So, do some kind of a neat effect here and move on.
Nicely done. An unboxing, really. So, as I was working on that, I did some rudimentary programming, the kind of programming you try to do when you're working with a brand new radio and doing a review, and you want to see what you can do with the radio before you crack the manual. And by the way, the manual is pretty good. I think I mentioned that its English was good, clearly written by someone who speaks English as a first language, and translated the Chinese into pretty good English and pretty clear step-by-step stuff. But I did get confused at the part about programming a memory. And programming memories in this radio is a little unusual. You don't program normally. I guess if there's a normal, from what we've learned from all of the Japanese radios, the ICOMs, Kenwoods, Yaesus, Alincos, they all do things pretty much the same way. You put the frequencies in that you want in the VFO. Then you put the offset in and the tone and anything else that is going to make the repeater parameters that you need to set. You put them all in VFO, and then you store that in the memory, and the memory remembers all of those things. So this radio does things a little bit differently. You can program the frequency and the offset and the tone, and then when you go to store that, the thing I ran into that was unusual was that it didn't store everything. It just stored the receive frequency. It didn't seem to store the transmit frequency. So that sent me to the manual to figure out what I needed to do differently. And the manual was a little bit confusing. I didn't quite understand it. And so I just played around until I came up with something that worked, which was to program the receive frequency in the VFO and store that. And I was getting the idea that you needed to store things twice, but the procedure didn't seem to work for me the way they were describing it. So I went to the VFO, I stored the receive frequency, I went back to the VFO, I typed in the transmit frequency and the tone, and I stored that on the same memory channel, and that worked. But that's not interesting that it worked, but that's not the procedure that they were directing me to. So let's see if I can figure out the right procedure now. So I've got 145.13 repeater. It is currently programmed in the VFO. It's got the receive frequency. This star button doubles as the reverse button. So when I reverse it, I see that I've got the transmit frequency. All of this still in the VFO, in the A side. There's a tone that's set. That's what the little CT says. So let's follow the procedure that they recommend for storing a repeater into memory. Push the menu button, and I can go directly to the memory setting
function by pushing 27. That's where the memory channel gets stored. So I don't want this channel. It is busy. I want to store into the next one up. And the way I know it's busy is by seeing the CH. I see there's something there. The CH goes away. There's nothing there. So now I will program. And it said receiving memory, not just storing memory, but it said receiving memory. And there's a clue there. So now I'll go back to the VFO.
Channel mode, frequency mode.
Make sure I'm still in the VFO. Now I'm going to switch the reverse button on that I showed you a moment ago and go back to the menu. Still memory channel 21 that we're going to load. And listen to what it says.
Transmitting memory.
So I stored it twice. Yeah, it's done. So I stored it twice, and now I'll go back to go to the channel mode or the memory mode and step up to 21 and take a look and make sure it got stored properly, and it seems to. I'll try to key up that repeater. I don't think I'm going to hear it very well. Yeah, there's a lot of noise in here from all this stuff. It's probably keying up. Or I might have screwed up the tone. I don't know. Okay, so that is more properly done, I guess. What they said in their manual worked, even though it didn't make sense to me initially. So that's the way to make it work. There's 125 memory channels in the radio. That these days is not a lot. It's okay. Probably good for most of you, not enough for me, but it's probably good for most of you. But to program all of them and to program them more easily, you don't want to do it on the control panel. You want to do it by software. And the software that they point you to is Chirp. At least the software that the place I bought it from pointed me to was Chirp. BaoFeng Tech, and they're who we are. They are a distributor. Not BaoFeng itself. So let me talk about that for a little bit. Because if you go searching for the company, they're going to be a little hard to find. And you have to do a careful look at all of the websites that you're being directed to. So this was one. And this is the one that I found when I bought it off of Amazon. Didn't buy them from them directly, but I did go through Amazon. If you do a Google search for BaoFeng, you're going to find a lot of different companies representing themselves as BaoFeng. And this is the BaoFeng Tech, the one that I bought it from. And I kind of thought that that was the real Chinese company, but turns out that it was not. BaoFeng Radio US, an official US distributor. Buy two-way radios. The official website for BaoFeng Radio, I think that's the Chinese folks. Let's find out. Yeah, I think that's really the Chinese folks. From their home button. Yeah, it's the group of radios. Yep, this appears to be them. Now, here's something interesting. In products, they don't say anything about ham radio. Not at all. Professional, two-way mobile, accessories, but nothing about ham radio. The U.S. distributors that you look at, if you do a search, they're all talking about ham radio stuff. Let's look at one of the others. Yeah, these folks try to make themselves look like the actual Chinese company, but they're not. They're still another distributor. Okay, so back to these guys, because this is where we're going to get the software. And we'll look at their website. It is BaoFengTech.com. And looking under software, and we find out that the software that you use to program the radio, if I can keep the control of the website, is Chirp. And Chirp is a free open source software that was written by Dan Smith, KK7DS. I first encountered Dan at some D-Star forums.
Okay, so I'm Dan Smith, KK7DS, and I'm the author of DRATS, which is a piece of software for data transfer over your D-Star or other radio.
So Dan did that, and he also did this Chirp. And Chirp is designed as a open source free software for programming lots of different radios. Not every radio out there, but lots of them. And that's what BTEC or BaoFeng is using for their radios. So they're pointing you to a download, but that's really just to Dan Smith's own website. And they update this a lot to add new radios, and they want you to make sure you get the latest version. So I've already downloaded that, and I have installed it. I think the first thing to do is to plug in the programming cable. You might have to do this before you launch the software. I know it works if I do it first. So into a convenient USB connection. And now let me launch the software. If I just open a new file, I get something a little confusing. D-Star, other parameters, and I'm not sure what is really there. And I thought, well, I'll go try to set it for the right radio, and I don't see a way to do that. And then what I tried was downloading from the radio first. And the first time I did this, I didn't plug it in hard enough. They recommended plug in until you get a click. In fact, they even had that as part of the troubleshooting. It didn't work because you didn't plug it in hard enough. So there we go. Turn it on. And we'll go up to the software download from radio. And it gives me some options here. COM3 is the only COM port that there is for it. It's not a Kenwood. It is BTEC. I'm still a little confused about who BTEC really is. And the model is 5X3. And it's already going. And I think it's going to open up a new tab. Once it's done, yeah, there's the new tab with all the stuff that I've got programmed in it, including that channel 21, 145.13 that I just put in manually. And while I was dealing with a little computer issue, I discovered that I had put in the wrong tone. So I put in the right tone, and now we can key up and hear the repeater. There's still a lot of noise here, but it worked. KN4AQ testing. Somebody's going to answer me. You never get an answer unless you're busy doing something else and just want to do a quick test. Okay, so let's look at the software a little bit. The memory channels, again, there's up to 125, 127 it looks like. And the usual stuff. The receive frequency. You can program a name, and if you want to have a name in it, you have to program it in the software. You can't do that manually. Tone mode and tone frequency. And then you decide whether you want the offset to be plus, minus, or off, or I guess an unusual split. And the amount of the offset. The mode, and it will do narrow FM as well as wide FM. And that power thing, I've discovered, let me see, what if I get that set? Okay, I guess I got it set at low. In playing with the software one time before, I found in programming the radio, this power field got inverted. Everything that was set for low ended up high, everything set for high ended up low. And I'm not sure what it is now. So if you try that. And then there's a field for skip. There's also the ability to set a lot of things on the front panel. If you read the facts for Chirp software, they'll say they don't really intend to cover every button on the radio. It's mostly frequency programming and figuring out you'll do some of the other buttons by programming the radio itself. because they've got a limited amount of time and a lot of radios to try to get programmed. But here we go with a lot of the radio buttons covered. And a lot of other parameters. It will receive a broadcast FM too. I think it's this orange button, the call button. Yeah. Switched me to 91.5 FM that I had pre-programmed. A couple of other interesting buttons on here. There's this, what is it called? Oh, the monitor button. If you, it's doing its tricks. If you hold it, it opens the squelch. But if you just press it once, it lights up a flashlight. And if you press it twice, it flashes the flashlight. You have a beacon. And this call button, I'm going to do one more thing with that. But I want to go to a simplex channel. Let's see. 002. Yeah, that'll be a simplex channel. Not likely to attract very much attention. Because if I press and hold the call button, it goes nuts. You know, I'm not hearing the alarm. I thought I would hear it. I thought it made noise out of the radio. And I may have changed the setting so that it didn't. So here's a receiver. Let's try this again. Oh, yeah, there we go. What the heck? Yeah, okay, so, and it's going on and off. Now, there is a feature that every radio really needs. Are we done? Yeah, I guess we're done. Oh, boy. I guess the last thing I want to do is do a little comparison between these radios, because they are very similar. If you look at the display, let's make them all quiet. Okay, if you look at the display, you can see that there's two frequencies shown in both radios. They're very similar size. The BTEC is a little bit taller. And, you know, I don't think that it's officially BTEC. I think that label got added by the company that I bought it from. I think BaoFeng is it's just the real name of the radio. So they are very similar in size. Both very small, both very light. I'm having trouble doing this backwards. The Kenwood has 500 memories. The BaoFeng has 127. So that's sort of advantage Kenwood. Remember, this is $80. And this is currently selling for a little under 300 on a couple of websites that I looked at. So more than three times as much. So what do you get for more than three times as much? Well, one of the things about the BaoFeng radio is that, well, it's showing two frequencies on the display. It's not, and it will receive either of those two frequencies if you tell it to. It can't receive them both at the same time. So if something comes up on one of the frequencies and then something comes up later on the other, you won't hear the second one at all. The Kenwood will receive on both frequencies, and you can adjust the level of volume level that comes out, because there's only one volume control. So you say, well, how do I tell it how loud to be? There's this balance button, and is it? Yeah. So then you can set it to all one side, more on one side than the other, 50-50, and then more on the other side, and then all one side. A lot of people ask me, with so many radios in my car, how do you listen to all of them at once? And the answer is pretty much I don't try to listen to them all at once. Although I can, with some spatial diversity in the speakers in the car, and adjusting volume the way I want things. I can have one radio as the primary one I'm listening to and know that there's traffic on the other and sort of listen to it in the background. With the handy talkie, the idea is not having two frequencies going at once and trying to listen to both, even though I can adjust the volumes somewhat differently. The idea is one frequency is your entertainment, and the other frequency is the one that you're sort of guarding to monitor for specific traffic that might come up there. So you listen to a repeater, it's quiet, there's nothing going on, but somebody may be going to call you later on that repeater, or you just want to be aware of any traffic that comes up. But you don't want to be stuck just listening to that repeater for that traffic. So you can listen on the other side of the radio for anything you want. Find a repeater that's busy and is entertaining you. And then if something comes up on the repeater that you've been kind of guarding in the background, well, then you'll know right away. With this radio, that won't happen. You'll be stuck on the one frequency that is actually making noise. That may be the big difference. I'm trying to think if there was anything else that there's a few things about this radio. And I think that Kenwood announced that with their new D-Star radio, this one is going to be phased out. I'm not sure what the new radio is going to be able to do, but I do know it's going to be a whole bunch more expensive. This radio covers from down to the AM broadcast band up past 1200 megahertz, up to about 1300 megahertz. So real wide coverage receiver. This is a fairly wide coverage receiver, but the more conventional VHF, UHF, and 220 megahertz stuff. In addition to being able to receive FM and narrow FM and wide FM, broadcast FM, and AM, it has a CW and sideband detector. So you can, especially on HF, but even on 2 meters and 70 centimeters, you can switch to the sideband detector and copy sideband. It doesn't have great filters. You know, it's not going to rival a Flex or an ICOM 7800 or even my 7000 in the car, but you can hear that stuff. And if you put a good outside antenna on it, you can actually hear broadcast all over the place. So yeah, if those things are of value to you, it is kind of worth the extra money. But like I say, for your first radio or for sort of a backup radio, something to just toss in the bag and have available to you, this will do the job. There is one other thing that we'll get into in a moment that is a concern with these radios, and I'll try to describe how much of a concern it ought to be. But I'll mention, I think I showed this during the unboxing, that it comes with two separate antennas, one for 2 meters and 440 and one for 220, because evidently you can't make a tri-band antenna in this form factor. This is the original Kenwood, and it just didn't work very well on 220. So I put this longer antenna on it, and that works on all three bands, and it works pretty well. And it works on 2 meters and 440 better than the short one does. It's pretty expensive, though. This is the Diamond. Comet makes one, and I found them for about $45, which is half the price of the radio. So the BTEC folks had this antenna for $17 compared to almost $50. So the thing that you might want to be concerned with is that these radios have had some trouble with harmonic output and not meeting FCC specs. Some of the Baofengs, usually not the Oshings, the Waksans, some of the others have missed their harmonic specifications by some, a couple of dB, sometimes considerably more, but mostly by a couple of dB. So what does that mean? Well, the second harmonic of a 2 meter signal, and it's the 2 meter band that's caused them the problems. The harmonics of the 70 centimeter band all fell within specs pretty well in the measurements that I have seen done. So the second harmonic of the 2 meter band, let's say 145 megahertz times two, is 290. If I got that right, trying to do the math in my head, just under 300 megahertz. And that's government band, military. We don't know what's operating in there. So you might be putting a weak signal, and it'll be a very weak signal, but you might be putting a weak signal into military band. And your audio is going to be there. They're going to know who you are. So you're taking a minor risk. The third harmonic falls into the ham radio 70 centimeter band. And the third harmonic was typically worse than the second harmonic in the tests that I saw. It's usually the one that went above spec. So that's going to be in the ham radio band where it might interfere with a ham. Again, it's going to be a very weak signal. If you're putting out a 4 watts in high power, the harmonic signal isn't going to be milliwatts. It'll be microwatts. But it could be heard a few hundred feet. And if you're going to a repeater that's a couple hundred feet high, it could be heard a couple thousand feet. So you got to decide, do you want to risk transmitting under conditions like that? Most of you won't know because you don't have a spectrum analyzer. You're not going to be able to tell your particular radio, whether it's going to meet specs or not. And I think as time goes on and these radios are produced more professionally, perhaps, that's going to be less and less of a problem. I did an interview with ARRL at the 2014 Dayton Hamvention, and they were testing radios like just like this. Well, not like this one because it hadn't come out yet, but other BaoFengs and other Chinese radios, and they looked at some Japanese radios. And I did an interview, and we looked at some of these radios and tested their performance, and I think you'll find that interesting and enlightening and perhaps not decision-making.
Okay.
Let's see how much power you put out first, though. 4 watts and dropping rapidly. Okay. Cut.
Okay.
4 watts on the 2 meter band. All right. So that means for a 4 watt transmitter, you need at least 52 dB of harmonic suppression so it complies with FCC emission standards.
Right.
Well, let's see what it does.
Let's see how bad this thing is.
All right. Go ahead and transmit, please.
Okay.
Here we go. Yeah, okay. Let go. Thank you. We'll use our marker again, and we'll set the reference points. You're there, and go over to the delta. Let's see. In second harmonic, where'd it go? There it is. You're at minus 49. You needed at least 52. That's 3 dB. It's not horribly off, but again, like the other handheld, you have a third harmonic, which is at minus 41. Oh, dear.
Yeah.
And the fourth harmonic is at minus 44. Does not comply with FCC emission standards.
Does not comply.
Does not comply on the 2 meter band.
Okay.
And, minus 60. Bob Allison, WB1GCM, is your test engineer. I work at the ARR laboratory. I do all the testing for product review. That's my job. So there's your handhelds. And I'm going to be printing out that one, too.
Yep, if you would, please.
And this data is useful because, well, we find out what makes the models we won't advertise in QSD, because if they don't comply with FCC emission standards,
you won't advertise.
We can't advertise it.
That's,
and eventually,
I'll tell you, it's a learning procedure for me as well.
Yes.
You know, I've been a ham for 50 years, and I don't want to operate on stuff that, I mean, it was kind of fun to play with these, but
What's most important is, as an amateur radio service, we don't want to have the reputation of using substandard equipment.
Right.
That's all the more fodder for our other commercial services to want our frequencies.
Yes.
So, you really are on the lookout for all that stuff.
You know, I've got better equipment at home, and it's just a matter of do I want to take the risk of carrying it with me?
Try it
and
over,
yes, I do.
Over here.
Maybe I can use it on 440.
You can use it on 440.
All right. Take these with me. Thank you so much.
You're welcome. Oh, hi.
Bob, we work together. I don't know if you know that.
Hi, Gary. Of course, Gary Pierce. Hey, how about that? Hi, Gary.
So the last radio I looked at was the Yaesu FTM 400 mobile radio.
Yes, indeed. Yes, that's a very nice transceiver.
Yeah. You got that back now?
Got it all back, yes. Thank you. Got them both back.
Okay, good. What are you doing here?
Well, what we're doing is we're testing handheld transceivers for emission standards. We're identifying makes and models for handhelds that don't pass FCC emission standards. We want to look at them to see what kind of harmonics they have, their spectral output, and to make sure that they comply with FCC emission standards. Those that don't, we just won't advertise that in QST.
So you were looking at a couple of BaoFeng or BaoFeng just a moment ago and didn't do so hot.
No, they didn't. Many of that model, they don't do very well. We identify that. And eventually, we're collecting a lot of data here. Not just a handful of handhelds, but a whole bunch. And we've done this same testing last year here at Dayton. And we've also done it at Pacificon in 2012. And we're collecting enough data so we get firm numbers of what makes and models do not comply with FCC emission standards.
So you get to look at a bunch of different radios, many of the same model. As you look across many of the same model, what kind of variability do you see? Are they very consistent or are they all over the map?
They're fairly consistent. Either they'll be have the same level of harmonics, for instance, like the BaoFeng, or they'll be consistently very, very clean. Now, just by observation, the Yaesu, Kenwoods, ICOMs, even Olinkos, they do very, very well spectrally. And we'd like to see that. That's great. And some of the cheaper radios, I'm not going to label any single one manufacturer or any country, but the cheap radios, well, you get what you pay for. And some of them are pretty awful. Some miss by just a couple of dB. We can almost give them a pass for that. But those that miss by 10 dB, 20 dB, 30 dB, we kind of raise our eyebrows at, we take note, and we're writing down all the data, and we're actually printing out the spectral plots from our spectral analyzer, those that really fail by a lot.
Tell me about this little toy you got here.
Well, this toy is it's actually a really halfway decent, pretty doggone good, Regal DSA815TG spectrum analyzer. And this does up to 1.5 gigahertz. The minimum resolution bandwidth is 100 hertz, so it's not really good for close-in measurements, but for most measurements, it's very good, and it's excellent for what we're doing today, and that is checking handhelds for spectral purity.
Besides the FCC rules, what's the real-world issue with a radio that doesn't meet those specs? What kind of problems can it cause out there in the world?
Well, it might interfere with potentially with other radio services. The second harmonic of 2 meters falls within government frequencies, and there is a chance, however slight it might be, there is a chance that it could interfere with other radio services. And certainly, as a radio amateur, we want to make sure that our equipment is clean and we do not cause interference from other services. Many hams will be quite upset if they get interference from something else, but yet some turn a blind eye about transmitting with harmonics. They just want that cheap radio, and that isn't always really the best idea. And we've seen some of the cheap radios pass today. Now, the BaoFeng UV3R, for instance, has failed, and failed pretty bad. There's a chart right over my shoulder that shows spectral plots of the UV3R. That was published in QSD Magazine as a technical correspondence by me. But we had a UV3R that passed with flying colors today, and I was very, very happy to see that. We want radio manufacturers to do well.
What would account for that that change for the one that passed?
Well, I think maybe the word got out that the BaoFeng, the manufacturer, should look a little closer at their bandpass filters to make sure they're passing only 2 meters while transmitting on 2 meters. It's a filter at the output that they maybe weren't careful enough to look at and measure. We don't know. We can't really speculate. I've tried to contact the manufacturer, but sometimes
I was going to ask if you communicate with them and have any dialogue.
One thing that we're very proud of in the ARRL laboratory is if there are any problems with anything that I find, transceiver, a power supply, we contact the manufacturer right away So they have plenty of time to work out any issues that we've found well, long before anything goes to print. That way the manufacturer gets to address those issues, make the corrections. We report in the product review what the initial problem was, what the manufacturer did to fix it, and also what kind of warranty will be honored, and what the, if, how the modification, the fix, is going to be covered as part of warranty work.
Most hams don't even have access to, certainly can't afford, a piece of test equipment like that. So where do they go to learn whether their radio is going to be good or bad?
Well, they can come here, here at Dayton. But I'll say this, a distributor who buys a load of these handhelds, it's in their best interest to invest in maybe $1,300, $1,500 in a spectrum analyzer such as this, because you get to see what they're importing if they pass. Now, one thing that we have worked with, we've worked with many distributors that have purchased handheld transceivers that do not pass, or I should say do not comply with FCC emission standards, and they know this now. And what they've done is they've purchased spectrum analyzers, so when they get a shipment in, they can check them out. And we're always more than happy to help out a distributor if they get a radio in or a model. Sometimes, if we want to advertise that model in QST, we get a sample just to make sure that it actually complies with FCC emission standards.
And I guess also, you know, check the reviews. Check what you guys publish in QST. That'll give you an idea of whether something you're going to get will be a good radio or not.
Well, that's true too, Gary. But also, most importantly, if you don't see a handheld advertised in QST that you're interested in, chances are, well, we haven't tested it, or it doesn't pass FCC emission standards. So if you don't see it in QST, well, do some more digging.
And until these, the current crop of really inexpensive imports, mostly from China, have arrived, you probably didn't see that many really non-compliant radios. That would be my guess.
Well, I can only say what I've tested in the laboratory, the different handhelds. Before the wave of the other new country that's into the handheld market, the handhelds that I have tested pass FCC emission standards with flying colors. With this new wave of inexpensive equipment, we've seen many of them fail. Not all of them, though, but some. And what we're doing, again, here is identifying makes and models of handhelds that don't comply with FCC emission standards.
All right, Bob. Well, thank you very much. I appreciate the valuable information.
Well, thank you very much, Gary. Thanks for coming over here and talking to me. Any way we can help out the radio amateur, that's what we're here for.
And I'll be looking forward to the next radio to review.
Okay, thank you very much.
Send me a good one.
All right, 73. Bye, folks.
So thanks, Bob. So it's up to you. Little bit of potentially high harmonics, limited number of memories, which probably won't be a big deal for you unless you're like me and you really fill up radio memories with all kinds of bizarre things to do. It doesn't have banks. I like memory banks. I like being able to cluster things I'm going to use for specific purposes into a memory bank where they're all together. And as you turn the dial, you don't get other stuff. This Kenwood doesn't have memory banks either. It's actually pretty long in the tooth. I think this is getting close to 10 years old. And but it does have the ability to set scanning in 50 memory channel blocks. So if you want to scan something in particular, you put those into one of the groups of memories from 1 to 50, 51 to 100, etc. And then you can set it so that it will scan just those 50 memories instead of everything. So, and this gets all that HF stuff and sideband CW. You can practice your CW with this radio. So this is much more limited, much simpler, but much cheaper. So I don't see a problem going with this radio or any of its cousins, the Oshings. I haven't tried manual programming on the Oshings Waxons. So I don't know if it's more difficult than this. You'll be able to get it with some practice. It is totally programmable from the front panel, except for that the memory channel name. You can't put the memory channel names in. You need to do the software. But most of them come with, most of the places you buy this from, it comes with the programming cable. If not, it's cheap, and the Chirp software is free. You can make a contribution to Dan. He'll appreciate it. And I don't see why not. It's got its limitations, but limitations that you can probably live with until you decide to get into something a little bit more elaborate. So, I'm the bull. There's the China shop. There's the pig. HamRadioNow.tv. That's where Arvin wants you to go. And make a contribution if this hodgepodge episode helped you out at all. And enjoy cheap radios. I'm Gary Pierce, KN4AQ. Over and out.